Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Sunday, August 12th, 2018. It is the 12th Sunday after Pentecost. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock. Our organist is Greg Nolte. The flowers on the altar in the sanctuary were presented by Pastor and Gina Pollock in memory of Gina's dad, Raymond Schwartz's birthday, Janet Hogue in memory of Roger Hogue. Our reader today will be Connie Singleton.
Confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may be light in your will and walking in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We now begin our worship with Be Thou My Vision, page 384.
Elijah went a day's journey into the wilderness, and came and sat down under a solitary broom tree. He asked that he might die. It is enough now, O Lord. Take away my life, for I am no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under the broom tree and fell asleep. Suddenly, an angel touched him and said to him, "Get up and eat." He looked, and there at his head was a cake baked on hot stones in a jar of water. He ate and drank and lay down again. The angel of the Lord came a second time, touched him and said, "Get up and eat. Otherwise, the journey will be too much for you." He got up and ate and drank. Then he went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mount of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Person up on the
and they shall all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except the one who is from God, he has seen the Father. Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is a bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. Of course, our picnic, annual church picnic, is immediately after the service today. We plan to eat around 12:15, 12:30, give everyone a chance to arrive and set up. So please join us, even if you didn't sign up. There's always plenty of food, so please join us out at the reservoir, the same place. We've been meeting for the past several years. Down from the information building, where it is on the table. Picnic immediately following this service. Let us now sing Spirit of God, descend upon my heart, page 4, in your worship.
We believe that God is the author of all life in heaven and on earth. We believe that Jesus Christ is the Lord of life. He died on the cross to defeat the power of death, and was raised again to bring the great resurrection and life to all who trust in him. He lives and rules among us now and for all eternity. We believe that the Spirit of God has lived upon us, daily giving us new birth, filling us with grace and truth, and bringing us into one life with each other, in harmony with the whole creation. We praise God for life.
So then God tells Elijah to already Jezebel is killed by two prophets of the Lord. So Elijah feels like he's all alone. There's nobody left to believe. He flees down into Judah. And he goes out in the wilderness, and where we pick up the story today, he is under a broom tree, praying to God that he take his life, where he's all alone, and his journey is over. Now, before this happens, we have that famous story of the contest on Mount Carmel, where after confronting Ahab, Elijah said, "Bring all the prophets to Baal up on Mount Carmel and let them have a contest with him." So the 450 prophets of Baal gathered on Mount Carmel against Elijah. And Elijah said, "Here is the contest. You build an altar and I'll build one. We'll each take a bull and slaughter, put it on the altar, but not light the fire. We'll then pray for our God to bring fire down and consume the sacrifice." And he says, "Baal, prophets, you may go first." So the prophets of Baal picked the bull they wanted, slaughtered it, cut it into pieces, put it on the altar. And then they began to pray to Baal to send down fire. And the writer tells us it started about 8 o'clock in the morning. At noon, Elijah began to mock them, saying, "Cry out, for he is a god. Either he's musing, or he's relieving himself, or he's on a journey, or perhaps he's asleep. He must be awakened." And they cried, aloud and cut themselves, as was their custom, with swords and lances, until a blood gushed out upon them. As midday passed, they raved on until the time of the offering of the oblation. This was an offering of Jewish people at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So that's about 3 o'clock. They still haven't heard from Obed. So, now it's Elijah's time. Elijah says to the people, "Come near me." And all the people came near him and prepared the altar of the Lord that had been thrown down. And he made a trench about the altar, great as it would contain 2 seahs of seed. The wood in order and cut the bull in pieces and laid it on the wood, and he said, "Fill 4 jars with water and pour it on the burnt offering and on the wood." And he said, "Do it a second time," and they did it a second time. He said, "Do it a third time," and they did it a third time. And the water ran around the altar and filled the trenches with water. Then Elijah calls on God, and immediately God sends down fire. And we read, "Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt offering and the wood and the stones and the dust, and looked up the waters that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and said, 'The Lord, he is God, the Lord, he is God.'" Elijah said, "Seize the prophets of Baal, let not one of them escape." So here Elijah has had great triumph. But then Ahab tells Jezebel of what happened. She's furious that all the prophets have been killed. So she sends more people out. So this is where we pick up the story today. As I said, Elijah's in the wilderness and Judah is under a broom tree. He's asking God to take his life because he feels like his greatest accomplishments has happened. There's nobody yet left to worship God, even though the people have said all that and said God is God and gave the impression that we were worshiping. And so he falls asleep. An angel of the Lord taps him on the shoulder, tells him to wake and eat. And there he some bread and some hot stones in the jar of water, and Susan goes back to sleep. And then we read, "And the angel of the Lord came again a second time and touched him and said, 'Arise and eat, for the journey is too great for you.'" This message, not only for Elijah, but this message is for us as well. The journey is too great for you. You see, in Hebrew, the word journey literally means your course of life. So what the angel is literally saying, your course of life is too difficult. In other words, if you try to live your life without God, if you try to live your life without the Lord Jesus Christ, if you try to live your life without feeding and feasting on the bread of life, then you're going to be lonely. Even though you have people surrounded by you, even though you have a family, even if you have a huge family of 12 brothers and sisters, and they all marry, they all have kids, so that your extended family is so big can fit in one act. We still can be lonely if God and the Lord Jesus Christ are absent, and your life is going to be too difficult. We don't like to be alone in trial or tragedy or tribulation. We don't like to be alone in a violent thunderstorm. We don't even want to be alone in a tornado or a hurricane. We don't want to be alone. strengthen us, to assure us of the forgiveness of sin, and the promise of everlasting life. For where there is forgiveness, there is salvation. Where there is salvation, there is eternal life. That's what the Bible teaches us, over and over and over. And so Jesus, by feeding on him, we are never alone, because he's always with us. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, he directs us and is with us. This is why it is important to go to church. I'm always asked by people, oh, is it really necessary to go to church? Can't I just read my Bible alone? Well, do you? That's the question. Do you read it? Or, you know, I can worship God in nature. I love nature. I can worship God by hiking in my favorite valley or favorite mountain, or I can worship God on a golf course or in my favorite fishing hole. Well, you could, but before you tee off on the ninth tee, you really take out a pocket Bible and read it and then sing some hymns of praise to God and pray before you swing that golf club on that ninth tee to try to finish your round of golf. After you've caught a fish, you wheel it into the boat, and you let it go, or save it to eat it. Do you then take out your pocket Bible and read an Old Testament lesson, an epistle, and then a gospel lesson, and then pray to God and sing psalms and hymns of praise to him? Some might, but I doubt the majority. Others say, well, I can watch TV preachers. Well, it's true, but the problem is that oftentimes what you're watching is a videotape of a service that happened maybe a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago. You can go on YouTube and you can watch a Christmas Eve service, an Easter service from a year ago. And it may be beneficial to you, but it's still not worshiping in the community and alive. I remember one old preacher that used to get on TV and at the end and claimed to have a tired feeling, and he would say, you know, if you got a child that's sick, bring him, stick whatever part of him sick up against the TV screen, or you know, take, if you're sick, you know, take, if you got a bad hip, stick it up against the screen against my hand, you know, point his hand toward the camera and all that. Well, one day another famous preacher, one Sunday preaching, he talked about this guy, he said, of course, he's not telling you that that broadcast you're watching was made a month ago. And he says, I don't read any of the scripture that says the power of the Holy Spirit could be videotaped and come through the screen 4 weeks later. He said, what I keep waiting for him to say is take your hand and stick it in the back of the TV. You get a real chuckle. You get a real plus. Now, 20,000 votes in the TV. So we have to be careful about TV. And it's still not worshiping in the community where we learn from each other and we experience things. And we have that sense of strength. There's an old saying of strength in numbers. And there is. That was Elijah's problem. He didn't feel like there was anybody with him, so he felt totally alone. He felt now he was useless to God. He had this great crown on that pearl, but now Jezebel was after him. Everybody was after him. What was he to do? So God let me die after my last glorious moment. It was just me. And then God remained in there 7,000 people who did not kneel to Baal. They remained true to him. And it's not. For our faith in Jesus Christ, we are not. You see, there are some concerns about the many gospel women in the church. He made it clear that he has no objection to churches getting better organized, serving better coffee, or replacing wooden pews with theater seats, but he was concerned about the disappearance of the Word of God. What bothers me, he wrote, is a consistent and somewhat humanistic message of human potential, personal fulfillment, and hope for prosperity, together with an obsession for self-esteem that is proclaimed from pulpits that rarely hear the echo of solid exegesis or communication of the content of Holy Scripture. He went on to observe that this soul-shrinking gospel serves only to distant people from what makes the biblical gospel good news, the majestic, mind-blowing beauty of a transcendent, holy God who graciously condescends in the person of his Son to absorb in himself the punishment we all so richly and eternally deserve. What is missing from many churches is the breathtaking splendor and heart-thumping glory of the revelation of God in the face of Jesus Christ. That is what you have to worry about in many churches and some of your teaching churches. It's all about being personally satisfied, prosperity, your human potential, self-esteem, etc., etc. Nothing about Jesus Christ crucified. Nothing about the need of repentance. Nothing about the need for absolution. Nothing about that in the cross of Christ is where salvation comes. So, after observing this, he then went around and asked people who belonged to many churches and others opinions about their church. And here's what he gathered as a basic summary of what people said. Well, we've got a great youth program, and there's plenty of parking space, but honestly, it doesn't seem like our pastor spends much time in the Word. He'll read a passage here and there, but he never goes very deep into its meaning. I get the feeling he doesn't think it's very relevant to our lives today. He shows some interesting video clips from recent movies, and he's up to date on political events, but Scripture doesn't play a huge role in our services. I've even stopped bringing my Bible to church. I never seem to need it. He sums up this by saying, neglecting the Word of God to be your own thing is as old as the Old Testament itself. And that is what we see in our Old Testament lesson. People of Israel had begun doing their own thing instead of God's. And so Elijah, prophet of the Lord, was lonely. He was lonely for a people who would be obedient to God, who would worship God as he was supposed to be worshipped, and who would live according to God. We become lonely when we allow ourselves to drift away from Jesus Christ. When we allow him, I'm not talking about the shut-ins, I'm not talking about people who have medical conditions that make it difficult for them to come to church, or people who just had surgery, or whatever. I'm talking about your normal backsliding Christian. When they backslide away from the community of faith, they risk being lonely. They risk being confronted with situations in life that are more difficult than they should, because they have forgotten that Jesus Christ is with them. So we never have to be lonely, no matter the situation, because as Jesus said before his ascension, lo, I am with you all, to the close of the day.
Amen.
Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Let us now sing All Who Come Together Gladly, page 5 in the bulletin, as the offering is delivered.
Amen.
please. For the church, the world, and the needs of all people, let us pray to the Lord. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, feed your church with the life of your dear Son. And by the power of your Spirit, raise him up on the last day as the very bride for us. Grant that all pastors, priests, bishops, and theologians may feed your people with your living word, so that many taste and seek your graciousness and are forever blessed for trusting in you. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Grant strength and encouragement and refreshment to all whose lives are in danger because they name Jesus as Lord. Make your witness shine the light of your judgment and your forgiveness in the hearts of their persecutors. Use your missionaries to feed many hearts with the word of life and salvation. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Turn the hearts of all in this parish toward you, their life and salvation, their living bread and eternal hope. Bless our words and deeds, our worship and fellowship, and use them to glorify your name and nourish the hearts of our neighbors with food that satisfies. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Keep in your care all who are single by choice or by circumstance. Help them to find their joy and fulfillment in serving you, and in strengthening the ties of Christian love that binds one to another. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Raise up among us wise and faithful rulers who are guided by your word and anointed with your Spirit. Incline our ears to the cries of the needy and to the instruction of your prophets. Help us all to know the true justice and lasting peace are founded upon your commandments alone, and give us strength to live accordingly. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Strength, guide, and shield those who serve in our military, all first responders, and all who stand in harm's way on behalf of others. Bless their families and friends, and help all of us to appreciate your and honor their service and their sacrifice. Grant them swift and joyous reunion when their task is done. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You fed Elijah in the wilderness, and you journeyed 40 days in the strength of that food. We pray that you would grant the bread of health and salvation to those who dwell in the wilderness of suffering, that you would strengthen them in their pilgrimage, and that you would surround them with compassion, friendship, encouragement, and that you would keep them steadfastly in faith and strong in hope. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We bless you for the lives of all those who have trusted in you and are now tasting and seeing the full measure of your gracious care. Give us true and trustful hearts. Draw us home to Christ, our living bread, our resurrection, and our life. And raise us up at the last day to rejoice in the fullness of the salvation we have prepared for your people. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Incline your ear to our prayers, dear Lord, and answer them according to your most gracious and holy will. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Gathered with one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit keep you in his light and truth and love, now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with our light poles on endless song, page 6.
Thank you.
be to God. That concludes our Sunday service. Join us at the drive-in, Melody Cruise drive-in on East 40, east of Springfield, for the 8 o'clock service. It goes until Labor Day weekend, and on Labor Day weekend, we will be having the pet blessing out there. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has a food pantry. It's open Wednesdays 9 to 10:45. Outreach store is open Monday through Friday 9:30 to 1, closed on Thursday, and the rainbow table every Friday from noon to 1. Everyone welcome.